Hello and welcome, friends. I am Nipunika Shahid, and the topic has been written by Mr. Shahid Saeed, Executive Editor, todaysworld.asia. Today's topics are rewriting the copy of Mofussil Correspondent and editing political and foreign copy. Let's begin. How to rewrite copy of a Mofussil reporter? A Mofussil reporter is the reporter who is not assigned on the regular basis. He or she works for the newspaper occasionally and not regularly. He or she is paid for that time only. Due to giving news at irregular intervals, he or she is not too much professional and thus lacks news sense sometimes. In India, this term is especially given to reporters placed in small districts and tehsil police. Thus, there is special need for editing such news. We need to be told if we make errors in copy editing. Assigning editors and Mofussil correspondents should know why changes are made. If a copy editor must make extensive changes in a story or routinely makes the same change in the same Mofussil correspondent story, we are obligated to communicate that to Mofussil correspondent or assigning editor, who should talk about it with the Mofussil correspondent. When a copy editor and assigning editor or Mofussil correspondent disagree about whether a change is needed, any questions of fact pertaining to reporting are referred to the line editor, who either answers them for the copy desk or contacts the Mofussil correspondent and then relays the information to the copy editor. Examples of this would be conflicting spellings of names, unclear paragraphs, and missing first references to sources. In general, copy editors do not contact Mofussil correspondents directly, but they may do so. Most of the time, line editors can answer questions without consulting the Mofussil correspondents because of their previous knowledge of the story. So, copy editors consult the line editor first. If further information is needed, the line editor calls the Mofussil correspondent. If no line editor is available, the copy desk may decide a call to a Mofussil correspondent. Any questions of fact pertaining to general knowledge and or style are checked with the appropriate reference source. Examples of this would be spellings of town names, historical events, grammar, capitalization and style. Copy can be edited as needed without consulting the line editor to make the Mofussil correspondent's meaning clear or to conform to style. Examples of this would be unclear writing, punctuation, and awkward sentence construction. Exceptions. The line editor is consulted if copy editors need to change the lead or quotation. If copy editors aren't certain what meaning was intended in a passage and in other special circumstances. For example, if a school superintendent uses poor grammar, there might be an argument in favor of leaving it as it is. If a Mofussil correspondent believes a significant error was edited into a story, then he should discuss the matter with the line editor to determine whether this protocol was followed. If the matter needs further discussion, the line editor should talk with the supervisor of the copy desk, who will try to determine where an editing error occurred. The copy desk supervisor will be responsible for discussing the error with the copy editor and determining corrective action, which can range from discussing the change with the Mofussil correspondent or line editor to writing a correction for publication. Mofussil correspondents may ask line editors to explain or look into significant changes or major errors following the chain of responsibility outlined above, and editors should provide such feedback when it is requested. Protocol. Minimizing errors is a team process for Mofussil correspondents, line editors, copy editors, and layout editors, and cooperation is key. Suggestions for Mofussil correspondents. Take your notes and stories with you when you leave work in case you're called for clarification. Call your line editor if you are particularly concerned about a story. Put notes of suggested cuts into your copy. Realize that space shortages are not the fault of the copy desk. Suggestions for copy editors. Realize that Mofussil correspondents are criticized for errors. It's easy for cuts to become personal to the Mofussil correspondent when his name is on the story. Mofussil correspondents must deal with sources who may have been offended or irritated by editing changes. Some stories aren't written in inverted pyramid and it's not always best to cut the ending. How to rewrite the political copy? Politics should be reported in the same way as other news, giving the same thought to the selection, gathering and presentation of facts and opinions. Story structure. Political stories can be written in the inverted pyramid style. However, because political issues can usually be seen from a number of different viewpoints, political stories are often more complicated to write than a simple report of an event. You need to include factual details of any measure or decision, but also report the different opinions on the issue. The simplest way of doing this is to start by giving one angle in the intro and first part of the story, then switch to the other views later. However, this approach can be unfair, especially in newspapers where the reader might lose interest before coming to the other comments. The best way to structure a news story to overcome this problem is to include a reference to the other opinions early in your story. You do not have to give them in full at the beginning of your story, you just need to mention them. Then you can explain them in more detail further down. For a full explanation of how news stories can move from the main inverted pyramid structure into a pyramid of pyramids, in the following example, we mention the alternative viewpoint of Mr. Mallikarjun Kharge in the fourth paragraph. The finance minister has introduced a bill to tax foreign property investments. Mr. Arun Jaitley says the tax is an attempt to stop people buying houses if they have no interest in living in this country. The Jaitley plan will increase stamp duty on house purchases by 100% but give all residents a full tax rebate on the extra amount. The plan has been attacked by opposition leader Mr. Mallikarjun Kharge, who says it will be difficult and expensive to operate. The bill was first drawn up in 2014 but was not introduced into parliament because of a lack of support in the Rajya Sabha. Mr. Jaitley says the measure now has the support of all government MPs, etc. In the example above, you would need to return to Mr. Kharge's comments later in the story after you have discussed the bill in more detail, explaining how it would affect your readers or listeners. This structure can also be used for long reports on radio and television. However, for short reports, it does not make sense to change from Jaitley to Kharge, then back to Jaitley and then back to Kharge, all in the space of just 6 or 7 sentences. News first. As with other news stories, you should give the news first, the comment second, as in the example above. The only time you give the comment first is if you're writing a follow-up or reaction story, in which case you refer back to the facts already revealed. In cases where your intro interprets an event or announcement in different terms, perhaps putting a human face on a political announcement, you should immediately explain it. In the following example, we give the human interest angle in the intro, the holiday, then explain in the second paragraph why children are getting an extra day off school. School children throughout the country will have an extra day's holiday this year. This is because the Education Department has made November 1st a day of national stock taking. More than 2,000 teachers in primary and secondary schools will be expected to spend the day counting books, pencils, rulers and other equipment. The human face. The example above shows the value of putting a human face on what could have been a very boring story about stock-taking. Most political stories are about people, but many politicians and bureaucrats hide their human face behind the way they talk about issues and events. This is because they are specialists in politics and government, not in communications. They see things from a different angle and sometimes concentrate so much on solving a specific problem that they forget how it will appear to ordinary people. So it is your job to express stories in human terms. What is happening to your readers or listeners, where they live, work and play. For example, if the politicians talk about urban renewal, get further details and write the story in terms which the people in the areas affected can understand. Compare the stories on the following page. See how the correct version concentrates on how the policy will affect the readers' or listeners' lives, while the wrong version lacks this human face. Right. 500 homes in the National Capital District will be pulled down to make way for a new entertainment center and shopping arcades. The demolitions are part of the NCD Commission's urban renewal policy, which will affect three areas of the NCD. More than 300 homes will be pulled down in Boroko to build an entertainment center. A further 100 homes in Hohola and Gordon will be demolished to build shopping arcades. Wrong. The National Capital District Commission has announced an urban renewal policy. The policy will mean that about 500 houses across the city will be demolished to make way for an entertainment center and shopping arcades. Politicians and public servants often hide the human face of events and issues behind difficult official language we call nonsense. Sometimes they use it to disguise the real meaning of unpleasant facts or decisions. The enemy is no longer killed, they are neutralized. Where there used to be the unemployed, now we have a pool of reserve labor. The list is endless. When faced with a complicated idea, do not be tempted to repeat it word for word and hope that some of your audience will understand. Your job is to cut through the jargon to show exactly how policies, rules and regulations will affect your readers or listeners. A good dictionary or advice from other journalists is necessary if you are to avoid passing on your own ignorance to your readers or listeners. Elections. One of the most important functions of the media in democratic societies is to act as a forum for the discussion of issues, especially during elections. The media also provide platforms for political hopefuls to be judged by the electorate. It is important, therefore, that in the run-up to an election, you are fair to all sides and do not favor one candidate or party over another. One practical way is to keep a running table of the amount of space or time you give to each party or political group and then adjust their coverage accordingly. Balance is best achieved by focusing on issues rather than on personalities. If you give all candidates the chance to discuss the issues, you will get an approximate balance. You should be particularly concerned with issues which will affect your readers or listeners. These include such things as housing, education, health, law and order, transport, agriculture and fisheries. Election results. When writing news stories in the run-up to an election and during the count, take special care that you give only those features which will be of interest to your readers or listeners without confusing them with unnecessary detail. You should report the winning party and winners in electorates relevant to your audience, as well as any significant losers, perhaps the defeat of the sitting member. You should indicate how big the winning margin was, and remember that in many countries, the new government does not exist until it is sworn in by the head of state. If you are presenting a special edition or program on election night, you have to plan well in advance. You must make sure you can get results quickly and accurately from reliable sources and prepare materials for background feature to fill in gaps. Journalists producing special radio or television programs should invite expert guests onto the show at certain times to break up what could otherwise be a very long and boring program. Try to mix interviews or profiles with up-to-the-minute reports on the latest state of polling or counting, giving regular summaries of the results so far. Many people will tune in during the program just for the latest results. If they do not hear a summary within 10 or 15 minutes, they will tune elsewhere or switch off. Although radio and television have the advantage of being able to present election results faster than newspapers, broadcasters are not able to give such detailed coverage. They can tell their listeners who has won, but radio in particular is not able to present the figures in the form of table which people can examine for detailed information. Newspapers, on the other hand, can present all the mass of detail for the readers to absorb slowly, studying the results which particularly interest them and ignoring the others. Newspapers will usually wish to publish a special results supplement with all the election results in it. This too will need careful planning, especially accurate calculations of how much space the results will need. The rest of the space will need to be given to stories summarizing the most interesting and significant results, giving information about people elected for the first time and similar stories. It should also include a table showing the new state of the political parties as a result of the election. Summaries. Tell your readers or listeners how political decisions will affect their lives. Your job is to report different opinions, not to judge them. Be objective. Cultivate a wide range of contacts. Write bright, interesting stories with a human face. Be fair to all sides. This is especially important during election time. How to deal with foreign news? It has long been a tenet of news editing that people aren't interested in foreign news. In the West, magazines apparently sell fewer copies with a foreign news story on the cover. Fewer people stay with the TV or radio news when it is dominated by foreign news outside of an extreme crisis. Yet, as we have seen, globalization is merging the foreign and domestic news agendas. What happens abroad has a greater direct impact on lives than ever before. Global terror is a domestic issue in the USA and Europe. What happens in Asia is home news for diaspora communities across the West. Climate change is a global problem with local effects. The performance of the Chinese economy can directly affect jobs and pensions in the UK or the USA. The world is more interconnected than ever. As globalization and migration require us to interact with other cultures and our economic, political and social interdependence with other countries becomes ever more apparent, so there is a growing need for UK citizens to have a greater awareness and understanding of the wider world and their place in it. But in spite of this imperative, do the public want to be taught about remote events and issues a long way from their front door? Do they really need to know about international policy issues? Journalistic experience suggests they are less interested in top-down international agendas, but respond strongly to crisis, drama, and human interest. So stories like the rescue of 33 trapped Chilean miners in October 2010 merit huge coverage over several days. Or during the Haiti earthquake, CNN deliberately focused on human drama with presenters personally rescuing a boy from mob violence and their qualified medical correspondent carrying out operations on victims on air. For some, this seems to cross any boundary of journalistic independence, but it was compelling viewing. Climate change talks, on the other hand, in spite of huge global significance, seem to merit at best a lukewarm public response. This leads to confusion over the genuine level of interest in international events and issues. By comparing a range of public research studies on attitudes to international news in the UK and USA, it is possible to identify some consistent themes among Western audiences. Even the majority of younger audiences follow the news to understand what's happening in the world. To know what's going on in the world, to know what's going on in the UK. For personal interest, for information about daily life, to get a perspective from another, to join in conversation with friends, as a duty to keep informed. Interest in specific stories. Although the interest in international news is high, the engagement in individual international stories tends to be more fragmented. BBC research shows higher levels of interest for global themed coverage such as terrorism, economics and climate change than for specific country coverage, reflecting a merging of the international and domestic news agenda. The top three issues for UK audiences were the economy, crime and immigration, the first and third of which have strong global narratives essential to a full understanding of the issue. International accidents and disasters tend to spike interest rather than ongoing conflicts or extended issues. The reporting of the Haiti earthquake in January 2010 produced some of the highest levels of engagement among BBC audiences. Outside of the election and the BP oil spill, interest in the USA was below average. Iran was very closely followed during the 2009 election, but much less so since. The conflict in Gaza at the end of 2008 was by some measure more closely followed than any other Israeli-Palestinian development. For UK audiences, the troop deaths and equipment issues in Afghanistan have meant that story was consistently more closely followed than most. This reinforces the sense that there is a low and fragmented level of interest in individual countries, but acute moments of crisis can attract significant attention. Are foreign correspondents redundant? Treatment of stories. Across all age groups, UK audiences, close to two-thirds, say they value seeing correspondents reporting directly from the country where the story is taking place, reinforcing the importance of eyewitness reporting. Just under half of them appreciate getting a perspective from another country. Having a familiar accent does increase the likelihood of audiences engaged in a story. However, if UK reporters are unavailable at the scene, they are satisfied with local commentary translated if necessary. This suggests their tolerance for local reporters may be higher than assumed. The public is able to separate the national importance of stories from the personal importance. For example, a survey showed 17% believed Afghanistan was one of the most important issues facing the country, but only 2% of them believed it was one of the most important issues facing their family. Again, this suggests recognition of the public interest importance of international news above purely personal interest. Conclusions. These findings are restricted to the UK and the USA and subject to the caveats surrounding all audience research. They are merely indicative of what those questioned say they believe. However, there are consistent findings. There is clear recognition of the importance of international news and of personal value in finding out what's happened in the world. International news is expected to be an integral part of any serious news offer. the more affluent and better educated demographics show greater interest in foreign affairs, leading to a potential knowledge divide about the rest of the world. Interest and understanding may be driven by news coverage. Areas which are little covered in the UK, for example, excite little interest even when they may be economically significant, like Brazil or China. It is possible to see in this the potential self-reinforcing downward spiral in terms of news coverage and public interest and understanding of global issues. This supports the arguments of those who believe the shrinking of international news coverage could have a detrimental social impact. However, providing a global context to national stories of interest does appear to be an opportunity to redress this to some extent. Interest in foreign news is fragmenting, as it is in all other categories of news, with deep niche interest in some subjects and cursory or headline interest beyond these areas. This supports the loss of the middle ground in international coverage and the shift of resources by news organizations towards breaking news and depth and analysis. The foreign feature coverage, which sustains correspondents and bureau in the past, appears to be little valued by audiences. Crisis still provoked the highest levels of engagement by a significant margin. Finally, the higher levels of interest among some ethnic groups support the view that multicultural mixed societies may require a differently balanced news agenda. And even beyond those groups, there is an acceptance of local reporters to a higher degree than editors may have assumed, although still a preference for correspondents who can culturally bridge between the international events and the domestic audience. With this, we conclude this session of rewriting the copy of Mofussil Correspondent, editing political and foreign copy. That's all for today. Thanks and goodbye.